Spectrophotometry. The basic spectrophotometer is used to determine the quantity of a specific molecule present in a solution. So, how does it work? Well, its function depends on the physical properties of the molecules being measured. Visible light of specific wavelengths is passed through a solution inside the machine. The light strikes the molecules in the solution. Some of the light is absorbed by those molecules. Some of the light is reflected or not absorbed. The spectrophotometer directly measures how much of the light passed through the sample and is either absorbed or transmitted. So let's take a look at visible light. We need to look at light as a form of radiant energy. There has to be a source of this radiation in order for us to perceive it. The sun, light bulbs, LEDs, lasers, etc. are all examples of common light sources we are familiar with. Here is the continuous visual light spectrum. Each color of light is actually radiation of a specific wavelength. If we look at the scale, we see that it is pretty much between 400 and 750 nanometers. That's the unit of measurement for the radiation. If we look at the electromagnetic spectrum in total, we see that the visible light is actually a very tiny fraction of the entire spectrum of radiation. And so, if we look at 400 to 750 as where we're familiar with visible light, what is beyond that? 400 and less is what we consider to be ultraviolet. And greater than 750 is what we refer to as infrared. As you can see from this chart, the energy of this radiation increases as the wavelength decreases. So you can kind of think of this as the wavelength being a measure of how often the energy in that radiation strikes the object. So the more often it strikes per unit of time, the greater the energy content of that form of radiation, which is why you don't want to be exposed to UV light, X-rays, and gamma rays for very long. But infrared, radio waves, and visible light do not harm us. Let's investigate what the phenomenon of color actually is. White light is a combination of all colors of light. The effect of a prism or diffraction grating on white light is that as each wavelength of light travels through it, it will not travel through the prism at the same speed and at the same angle. So each one will travel through at a different angle, and each wavelength or color of light will exit the prism separate from one another in a different location. Sometimes we like to simply refer to this as a rainbow. So as you can see in the picture to the left, white light enters a prism and it diffracts through the material at different angles and comes out separated in its components or each individual color. And then if we perceive things in the world as different colors, what does that mean? The color that something appears depends on what pigments they contain. The term pigments are molecules that absorb specific wavelengths of visible light. So you can physically change the color of an object by putting different pigments on its surface, like paint. Natural things like this flower appear red only because it absorbs all colors or wavelengths of light except for red. Thus, its pigments strongly absorb all the other colors of light, and it reflects the red light back at us. So the bottom line is, the color that something appears to us visually is the color that it absorbs the least. So we want to use this as a general guideline for looking at samples in the spectrophotometer. Whatever color the liquid appears, that's the wavelength of or color of light that it will absorb the least. So if we look inside a spectrophotometer, these are the basic parts. There's a light source, a lens, and then there's a prism to separate the white light into different wavelengths. The light then passes through a wavelength selector, which is basically a tiny little opening. And it's made small enough so that only one color or wavelength of light is able to pass through. Then that light that you select is able to pass through a sample, and then there's some kind of visual light detector on the other side of the sample, which will determine how much of the light actually gets passed through. And then you have a display to show you the result. Using a prism, one specific wavelength of light can be passed through the sample. The machine then is able to read and detect two different types of measurements. One is referred to as the percent transmittance value. The amount of that wavelength of light that passes through is measured directly. The scale ranges from 0% to 100%. Absorbance is the amount of light absorbed by the sample, and this is calculated based on the amount of light that is passed through or transmitted. This scale ranges from 0 to infinity, and as a note, absorbance doesn't have any units. The scales run opposite one another. High transmittance values, where lots of light is passing through the sample, is equal to a low absorbance value, less light being absorbed by the pigment molecules, and vice versa. So if you have a low transmittance value, you have a very high absorbance. And we use absorbance as a measure of how much there is inside the test tube of a certain molecule. Factors that affect spectrophotometer measurements. We need to consider these for our laboratory measurements and use of the equipment. Number one, the molecules must have some kind of color for it to work. If a molecule does not strongly absorb any wavelength of visible light, it will appear clear in solution, and in that state it cannot be measured. However, we can, under some circumstances, add an indicator molecule. Indicators change colors when they react with the colorless molecule we're trying to detect. The indicator then can allow us to indirectly measure the amount of the molecule by letting us measure the amount of indicator that changes color. Two, another factor is concentration. There must not be too much or too little of the molecule in the sample we're trying to measure. The spectrophotometer has limits in how it can detect. Three, light path, or the distance the light must pass through the sample, and this affects the measurement. If the distance that the light passes through is different every time, we cannot obtain reliable measurements. So we use a device or a container called a cuvette, which is made to have a specific diameter or thickness. And the one on the left shows a little registration mark, so you can put it into the machine the same orientation every time, so that the thickness of the light path is the same. Another thing that affects spectrophotometer measurements is calibration. You must not forget to calibrate the spectrophotometer before using it, like any measurement device. And we use something called a blank solution as a reference in order to zero out and set the maximum measurement value for calibration. A blank solution contains everything that is also in your sample tube, and also in the same amounts. The only thing it does not contain is the molecule you're trying to measure. And you must remember that the spectrophotometer must be recalibrated every time you set it to a different wavelength. If you calibrate the spectrophotometer at one wavelength and take multiple measurements at that same wavelength, you do not have to recalibrate it every time. But the moment you switch to a different wavelength, you must recalibrate it or you will not get accurate measurements. Number five is that there are detection limits on the spectrophotometer. You cannot obtain readings at concentrations that are too low or too high. So, in some cases, the machine will still be able to read transmittance values, but when you ask it to report an absorbance, you'll just get a blinking number or an error or something that can't give you a reading or value. So in those cases, you have to actually calculate the absorbance when the percent transmittance readings are very, very low. So refer to the handout to look at the formula for how to do this. You may have to dilute your sample further if it's too concentrated to measure. So if you put your sample in and you get 0% transmittance, which will result in infinite absorbance, you can't really use that as a reading. So you must dilute the sample down in order to make the reading more visible to you. So ultimately, we want to practice setting up the machine properly to be able to take some measurements. And in spectrophotometric analysis, in order to measure the concentration of a molecule, we have to go through several steps. First, you must create an absorbance profile for that molecule if you don't already have one. In some cases, these are published, and in other cases, you'll have to make them as you go in lab. Two, you must create a standard curve. Three, set the spectrophotometer to the optimum absorbance wavelength, and you get this value from your absorbance profile that you make, or that you can look up. You must also then measure the absorbance of your samples and record this data. Finally, you're going to use the absorbance data and determine the concentration of each sample using the standard curve that you made in step 2. So, step 1, creating an absorbance profile. Make a solution containing a known concentration of the molecule of interest. The solution should only be slightly tinted in color. You do not want this to be too concentrated again so that it's outside the detection limits of the device. You must remember to calibrate the spectrophotometer using a proper blank solution. Measure the percent transmittance and absorbance of this known solution at different wavelengths, and go between 400 and 750 nanometers. You may not be able to obtain the absorbance value in some cases, like we mentioned earlier, so from the transmittance value you'll be able to calculate that value. Start by measuring in 100 nanometer increments. Start at 400, then 500, 600, and 700. Find the two wavelengths with the highest absorbance values. For example, if 600 and 700 are the highest absorbance values, you want to see if there's even higher values in between, so you'll also take additional readings at 620, 640, 660, and 680. Ultimately, you'll want to create a line graph of absorbance versus wavelength so you can get a visual, quick reference as to how strongly your substance absorbs at the entire spectrum. The purpose of this is you'll use this data to determine what wavelength to use for measurements. Creating a standard curve is the next big task you must do. For this, you must make a series of solutions. Five or more is optimal. Each solution is going to contain a known concentration of the molecule you're trying to investigate or measure. Each solution of a different concentration ranging from high to low, so you'll purposely make them of different known concentrations. You'll make each concentration a fraction of the maximum concentration in your range. For example, if the highest concentration in your series of solutions is 0.1 milligrams per milliliter, then you'll make a series ranging from 0.02 to 0.1 in different increments, so 0.02, 0.04, 0.06, 0.08. Well, then you're going to use your absorbance profile to select the best wavelength to measure at. Then you'll calibrate your spectrophotometer using a proper blank. Then you'll measure percent transmittance and absorbance of each of these solutions in your series. From that data, create a line graph of absorbance versus concentration. And the purpose of this graph, this data, is so that you can determine the concentration of each sample or an unknown containing that particular molecule. So, some review questions. What do we use a spectrophotometer for specifically? What factors can affect spectrophotometric measurements? What is absorbance? What is transmittance? What is an absorbance profile and what is it used for? And what is a standard curve and what is it used for? This concludes the lesson.